morning, everyone. I'm going to talk about the cross from Luke 23, verses 26 to 56. If you've been a Christian a while, or grew up in the church, or if only attended a church service at Easter, or learned the story of Jesus at school, you will be very familiar with the story of the cross. The biblical narrative of how the battered, blooded, wounded Jesus Christ was led through the streets of Jerusalem to be put to death by being nailed to a cross with two criminals also executed either side of him. I'm going to summarize these events before drawing out some of the key points. Jesus, God's only Son, who created and loved every person involved in this heinous execution, did not defend himself or retaliate with words when nailed to the cross. He simply said, "Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing." In his moment of greatest agony, he prayed out of concern for those involved, for the soldier who hammered in the nails, the mocking soldiers who were only interested in gambling over ownership of his last remaining possessions, his seamless garment, the sneering rulers, the scoffing crowd, and one of the criminals also being crucified, who was baiting him to prove he was the Messiah. One of the criminals, in his final hours, admitted his guilt, defended Jesus, declaring he was innocent, and voiced his trust in him. And once more, Jesus reached out in love and promised the man that he would be with him in paradise that very day. As Jesus was dying, in his final hours, darkness fell over the land, and the veil of thick curtain in the temple that separated everyone from the Holy of Holies was ripped from top to bottom. Jesus didn't whisper his last words, he shouted them, "Father, I entrust my spirit into your hands." By his sacrificial death, he had made a way forever for all those who would believe in him to be forgiven and have full access to God and enter into an eternal relationship with him. It was so astounding that even the pagan Roman officer overseeing his execution worshipped God and said, "Surely this man was innocent." The crowd went home in deep sorrow. Other translations say that as they beat their breasts, which was a sign of mourning, they were very sad. A good and righteous religious leader, Joseph of Arimathea, gained permission from Pilate for Jesus' body to be taken down, wrapped in a linen cloth, and laid in a new tomb. How familiar are we with that narrative? And more important, how over-familiar are we with this astonishing story of Jesus' overwhelming love and his sacrificial death for us? Our King was nailed to a tree. Let us give thanks for his shed blood. The horrible suffering of the Lamb of God has been avoided by many because they feel it's too graphic to speak about or it is too vivid. But when we ignore reflecting on it, it dulls the thanks and praise that only he deserves. For all he endured on our behalf, he wants to show us what he went through. During the Roman rule of Israel, the cross was seen as a stigma where criminals were condemned to die. People viewed those who were crucified as villains, a disgrace, those who were being judged by God. Jesus didn't go through Jerusalem hidden from view in the dark, but in the complete daylight with onlookers lining the streets, and he had to struggle with all his strength after the ferocious whipping and beatings he'd endured. And he walked on and he suffered. When his body was too exhausted to carry on, a man named Simon carried the cross the whole rest of the way. However much he was having to bear physically, he also had to suffer the anguish of being turned into a curse for us. In Galatians 3:13 it says, "But Christ has rescued us from the curse pronounced by the law." When he was hung on the cross, he took it upon himself and to take the curse for our wrongdoing. For it is written in the scriptures, curse is everyone who hung on a tree. All of us should have been carrying that cross. We deserve the judgment that Jesus took in our place. The crucifixions were designed to cause an excruciating slow death that would last for hours. They could have just tied Jesus to the cross, but they chose to drive spikes into him instead, into his hands that healed, embraced, and forgave people. They were nailed to a tree. The feet that walked along the dusty roads to teach, heal, and deliver were then nailed through as well. While on the cross, he became our sin. The entire sins of the world were poured out on him at that time. He was lifted up in front of a crowd on the top of a hill. His suffering could be seen from every side and far away. These very moments were prophesied in the Psalm 22, verses 6 to 8. But I am a worm and not a man. I am scorned and despised by all. Everyone who sees me mocks me. They sneer and shake their heads, saying, "Is this the one who relies on the Lord? Then let the Lord save him. If the Lord loves him so much, let the Lord rescue him." May we never forget or cease to be thankful for his suffering and for the pain for us. Jesus exchanged his heavenly throne for a cross to which he was nailed on a tree of shame. Finally, as the price for all sin has been paid, he not only said in his final moments, "Father, I entrust my spirit into your hands," but in John 19:30 also records the three most wonderful words, "It is finished." Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. This declaration meant that the ultimate sacrifice for man had been paid in full. Jesus gave it for you and for me. When at the start of his earthly ministry, John the Baptist introduced Jesus, he said in John 1:29, "Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." Those moving words still ring true today. Jesus announced Jesus' primary mission to be sacrificial lamb for the whole world. Whether you have never asked him to save you, or you have been his for years, you can always experience his saving grace. Jesus never stops being our saviour. If you never come to him in humility, now is your moment. He is eagerly waiting. If you will humble yourself and admit you need him, you will find the greatest love of your life. He will never again mention your sins, and he will forever hold you in his arms. To say no one would be a tragedy, and as you're refusing a person, the very one who suffered and died for you, it means you want sin more than his sacrifice. Please seize this moment, as it may never come your way again. Hear his invitation. Come to me. God is speaking to your heart right now. His arms are open wide, and he's longing to hear you say, "Yes, the Saviour is waiting for you." Just a very short prayer. "Father, I have sinned against you. I'm sorry. I want to be saved. Thank you for sending your Son to the earth to suffer and die on a cross for me. Thank you for raising him from the dead. Jesus, be my Saviour. Please forgive my sin. I come to you because only you can save me. Wash me clean with your blood. You are the Son of God. I love you and will follow you forever and ever. Amen."